Good morning, Oakland City Church. The passage that we're going to look at today in Micah chapter 6, when I was growing up, this was always a passage that was taught to me in a very specific and a very particular way, kind of like a divine legal drama. You know, you can almost hear the dun-dun from Law and Order. God speaks through his prophet, "Hear, O Israel, everyone gather around, mountains, you too, come bear witness. Yahweh has a complaint against God's people. Come and hear the Lord make his case." You can sort of imagine the camera pans into this courtroom as Yahweh comes forward as the plaintiff, and he lays out exhibit A and exhibit B and evidence after evidence of Israel's wrongdoing until finally a gavel sounds and a judgment is pronounced. This is what the Lord requires of you: to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly. This is always the way that it's been taught to me. Maybe it is also the way that it has been explained to you. But over the last few weeks, as I have been studying this word, and over the last few days as I have been meditating, a very different word has come to me. And it is this very different word that I wanted to share with you today. See, I don't actually think that this is a courtroom scene after all. I think that this is about something so much more tender and vulnerable than that. I think that this has a lot more to do with the reproach of a lover than anything having to do with a lawsuit or a gavel. In other words, I think that this is a passage that has more to do with how to save your marriage and every other relationship than it has to do with how to win in court. So let me pray for us as we begin and go into the Word together. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. If we take a moment and come to the passage, let us begin by asking the question. It says that the Lord has a complaint against God's people. What is the heart and nature of God's complaint? What is God upset about? And we find the answer here in verse 3, when God says, "Oh, my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Oh, my own people, my own heart, how have you grown weary of me?" This is not the indignant, outrage, one-star Yelp review of a plaintiff that's trying to sue you or drag you off to court. This is the heartbroken, anguished cry of a lover or a loved one. This, God is calling the mountains to bear witness to God's bleeding heart. God is saying, "What happened to us? How do we get here? I never see you. We never spend time together anymore. This is not the marriage that I signed up for. I don't want to go on like this anymore." God is not dragging us into court. God is calling the mountains to bear witness to God's bleeding heart. It's not God who calls up the lawyers. It's Israel. It is Israel who hears the complaint and immediately starts to build up in armor. It is Israel who misreads heartbreak for accusation and goes immediately on the offensive. "What do you want? I've already given you everything that you asked for. Oh, you want more? You want 1,000 rams? You want rivers of oil? You want me to rip my heart out and show it to you? What? What do you want?" Have you ever been in that kind of an argument? Have you ever been in a relationship and it's like all of a sudden you're in that argument where you're just nitpicking the bullet points of what each other are saying? Your partner comes to you and says, "I'm so tired from taking care of the kids all day. I just really need you to be a partner and give me a break. I just really need you to be a partner and step up right now." And your response is, "That's not fair. I've been doing the majority of the cleaning, and I think, if I remember correctly, you went out with your friends just last week. And let's not even talk about that night when you were taking the super, super long shower, and I really had to pee, and I didn't even give you a hard time about it." Right? Or how about, "I just really need you to step up and be a partner for me right now." And your response is "This about what happened last Thursday? Because I thought we talked about this already, and I've already apologized." Like, I see, I'll own it. I've done this. I mean, I'm sure none of you fine people have ever made a mistake like that or been in an argument that was so silly, but I own it. I have totally done that. And by the way, nerd alert, the four things that Israel points out in verse 6 to 7, they're not innocent random things. They are actually examples of restitutions. They are things that God does and like accommodation that God asks of Israel after they have royally messed up in the process of making up. Like that phrase about my firstborn from my child. I don't know if you've ever thought about this, but do you know when it is actually instituted that the practice of Passover was actually commanded to Israel? It wasn't right after they left Egypt. It wasn't with the Red Sea. It wasn't even when they got to Sinai and God gave them the Ten Commandments. No, it was after the golden calf and after Adam's son super messed up in the tent that then God is like, okay, I don't know if I trust you to remember this properly anymore, so now we're going to do this. Every year, you're going to tell this story in this way of how on that day, my spirit passed over and spared all the firstborn sons. And by the way, they already belong to me. I don't need you to give them to me. They're already mine. But in my mercy, I will instead install Levites to mediate and pray in the temple on your behalf. They were restitutions. This is like that relationship where you're like, I'm not really the jealous type, but now you've done something bad, and I don't know if I can trust you anymore, so you are no longer allowed to text your ex or follow single women on Instagram. It's like that. And so here is this exchange where God is saying, I don't like the way that we are together. Our relationship makes me really sad. And Israel is immediately like, I can't even believe you're bringing this up. Why are you bringing up ancient history right now? Haven't I already paid for this? Didn't I buy you flowers every day the next week when I forgot about Valentine's Day? Didn't I take you on vacation to Hawaii like you wanted when I had to work late on our anniversary? What do you want? What is it going to take? What is it going to take for you to put this behind this and let me alone? And God is saying, you know, it just really seems like everything that I do is annoying to you, and I haven't done anything to be deserved to be treated like this. This is not about a courtroom drama. This is about a relationship crisis. You know, during COVID, there was a period of time I became really fascinated by conflict resolution. And I ended up listening to all these marriage podcasts. And I could just imagine the therapist, they would say over and over again that so many relationships end and so many marriages don't work out because the couples don't know the difference between restitution and repair. They would say, I have seen a 30% increase in divorce during this pandemic, and it's so tragic because, you know, the key is that as a couple, you need to know the difference between restitution and repair, and you have to get much, much better at repair. They give this example of a couple that's fighting about something really important, and in the middle of the fight, the wife realizes, oh, I have to go to work. And so she's packing up and she's leaving. And as she's walking out the door, she doesn't love where the conversation is right now. So she throws back this comment, or you know what? Just do whatever you want and I'll fix it when I come back. Oh, right? Just do whatever you want. I'll fix it when I come back. And she goes to work. And later in the day, between her meetings, she sees that she's got a text. And her husband has texted her and he said, why do you always do that? Why do you always slam the door? And like, she totally did, right? Like, let's be real clear and honest here. She totally slammed the door. She slammed the door on a conversation that wasn't ready to be finished. She definitely slammed the door on any sense of collaboration or shared responsibility. Just do whatever you want, and I'll fix it when I get back. Yeah, totally slammed the door. But what is the very human instinctive response? What did she actually write back in her return text? That's not true. No, I didn't. And by the way, our doors are soft close. It's not possible to slam our doors. Just lawyering all of the fine print details of this conversation, right? And the therapist is like, oh, you missed it. That was a repair opportunity and you missed it. You went immediately to this legal justification restitution place and you miss the moment for repair. And they say, this is what I want you to do next time. Next time you're in a conversation or a fight where you hear somebody say, you will always, or you're the one who always, instead of saying, that's not entirely true, or no, I didn't, I want you to say, of course I do. and think of a positive reason for why your partner inspires that behavior in you. Try to keep it going for as long as you can. So in that previous example, it's like, why do you always slam the door? The response could be, of course I slammed the door. This is the first relationship where I've trusted that you're always going to be home when I get back. And it's actually because you're such a loyal partner that I give myself permission to throw tantrums with you. And you keep it going. So the counter response to that could be like, well, of course I'm a loyal partner. We've been doing this for 8 of the best years of my life, and I still remember in year 1 when you da-da-da. And you keep going until basically you feel ridiculous that you're arguing over how awesome you're making each other's lives. Know the difference between restitution and repair and get better at prioritizing repair. I even see this sometimes in parenting. You know, I'm not a parent and I'm not married, but my girlfriend has a 5-year-old, so it turns out I'm doing a lot of things with 5-year-olds these days. And her little boy, he's so cute and he's so sweet and he's so bright. But he's 5, so he's still figuring some things out. And I remember there was this one day, I was in his bedroom, I was playing with him, and I have got this sort of like medium-sized plastic ball, and I'm lobbing at him, and he's throwing it back. And my girlfriend is in the corner, and she's cleaning or something. She's not really paying attention to us. And her little boy decides that it would be really funny to throw the ball at his mom. So I lob the ball, and he picks it up, and he's supposed to throw it back at me, but then he goes, hee-hee-hee, and he chucks it as hard as he can at his mom's head, and it almost hits her, right? So I see this and I just go, hey, scares him. He gets really upset and he runs out the door. In fact, I remember he stormed out and he slammed the door and it like wasn't enough. So then he opened the door and then he reached inside to press the button to lock it from the inside. And then he slams it again and he says, you stay in there. 7-8 minutes later, I look up from where I'm like reading something on my phone and he's standing in the doorway. He won't come in. And he says, Maximus, will you come play with me? Now, I have a couple of options here, right? I have choices in this choose-your-own-adventure game, right? He is by the door. I'm on the bed. I could say, not until you apologize to your mother, right? I can say, we'll play later. Come here. I want to talk about what just happened. I could say, that was really dangerous. People can get hurt. We have to be careful when we're playing. And that would teach him something, but I'm on the bed and he's at the door. That would also communicate something to him about our relationship. And those are examples what I would consider to be restitution first responses. We can't just go play. That would be like he got away with bad behavior. No, we have to do the restitution part first. But my girlfriend is a very firm believer in positive parenting. So against my natural instincts, I get up and I follow him out the door. I see that he has taken all of his toys and put them all over the living room floor. And I get on my knees, and he's bossing me around, telling me how he wants to play with him. And in a little bit of time, he comes up to me. He doesn't make eye contact, and he starts playing with the string of my hoodie. And he says, I'm sorry, I got mad. I put my arm around him, and his head is right here, and it's like I'm cuddling him. And I say, yeah, let's talk about what just happened. And then I say, can you apologize to your mama? And he looks up at me, smiles his big smile, and he says, mama, silly. And then he runs off to apologize to his mother. That's the difference between restitution and repair. And I believe we worship a God who cares more about repair than he does about simple restitution. Think about it. What is the end result of restitution by itself? Not letting them get away with it? Making things square? Paying off the debt? What is the end result of repair? Reconciliation, healing, and wholeness. Yeah. I think we worship a God who cares more about repair than restitution. And I believe the justice of the God that we worship goes so far beyond not letting them get away with it and will not stop until there is true healing and true wholeness and true flourishing. So there is this beautiful pivot that happens at this point in Micah chapter 6. After God has said, I don't want this kind of a marriage. Something has to change. And Israel has said, well, what do you want? Because I don't know. So you just tell me. I don't know. What is it going to take? Just tell me. What do you want? That the prophet steps forward and says, you want to know what God wants? You want to know God's repair language? I'll tell you. He has shown you, O man, what is good and what the Lord requires of you. He has shown you, O man, what is good and what the Lord requires of you. But we have to pay attention because there's more going on here than meets the eye. First of all, it says he has shown you. Not book knowledge, not legal code, not purification rituals. He has shown you. This is demonstrated lived experience. And it doesn't say he has commanded you, O Israel. It says he has shown you, Yadam, what is good and what the Lord requires of you. It says he has shown you, Yadam, what is good. That's Eden language. This is Eden language. This is God pulling Adam and Eve by the hands, running around saying, taste this, smell this, hear that. Are you feeling it? Are you experiencing all of these vibes? This is what is good. This is very, very good. And so then I don't think that the three phrases which come afterwards are meant to be bullet points or items on a checklist or itemized lines on an invoice of debts to be paid. No, I think that this is not a requirements checklist. This is a memory recall exercise to call us back to that place of original blessing and Edom Shalom. This is being in the marriage counselor's office, join us, and asking the question, tell me how you first met. Tell me when you first said I love you to each other. I don't want payback. I want a return to that place of original blessing. The three things, to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God, represent a picture of an original blessing. Not original sin, original blessing. And that phrase, walking humbly with your God, sometimes also more accurately translated to walk modestly or to walk discreetly. To walk in such a way as to not draw attention to your feet or your walking is a very different phrase than what it means to walk blamelessly before God when we are walking in front of God and God is evaluating us. It is also a very different phrase than what it means to walk faithfully in God's ways when we are walking behind God, taking care to put our toes only where the footprints are. To walk humbly with your God is a side-by-side, arms around each other, lock steps so as not to draw attention to how you are walking. This is a couple's walk. This is a lover's walk. This is a walk of intimates. This is an Adam and Eve running around the garden, naked and unashamed, flourishing and fellowshipping with God with no restraints. This is a call back to the original blessing of Eden Shalom. And so then the other two things must be ingredients to help us manifest a sense of Eden Shalom right here where we are on earth today. And I believe that is exactly what they are doing. To do justice, more accurately, should be translated to promote justice. In Hebrew, the words are asot mishpat. And mishpat is this community well-being word for justice. It doesn't mean to make good and bad moral judgments. That's to be a judge, not to promote justice. The examples in the Bible of people who did this kind of justice is Moses at Sinai pleading with God, I know they messed up, but these are your people, God, and your people need you. Please come with us. That was considered an act of mishpat, and it was counted to him as righteousness. Another example is Abraham pleading for Sodom and Gomorrah, of all places, saying, God, I know this is, but this is an entire city's lives at stake here. What if there were only 10 righteous people? Would that be enough to save the city? That was counted as an act of mishpat, and it was credited to him as righteousness. The opposite of doing justice is not to make bad moral judgments, but rather to promote only the interests of the rich and powerful at the expense of the orphan, the widow, the poor, and the needy. To asot mishpat is to care so much for the flourishing of your entire community that you would stand up and take personal responsibility so that no one would fall through the cracks. But wait a second. Isn't that what God asks Yadam to do in the Garden of Eden? Doesn't God call Yadam to say, I want you to tend and guard and nourish and nurture the flourishing of this entire ecosystem? This is about a return to a sense of Eden Shalom. In that second phrase, To love mercy in Hebrew, the words are ahava chesed, two words that in Hebrew both mean love, mashed together, but that first word, ahav or ahavat, it is a word that means desire, it's a word that means passion, it is a love that hungers to procreate. In other words, this is a be fruitful and multiply word. And now we're back in Eden again. But what this time are we called to be fruitful and multiply? Chesed. Sometimes translated as covenant love or patient love or loyal love. It's a weird, peculiar word. It is the love that comes from looking at someone or something who is different and other and loving them like they're one of your own and promising and committing to stick by them. It is a description of how God loves us. Here we are, creation beings, just like trees and animals. And yet God looks on us and loves us like God's own children, and God commits to stick by us. The opposite of multiplying chesed is not just to love in like a lukewarm way. No. By its very nature and definition, love always finds a way to grow. The opposite of multiplying chesed is to multiply the things that make other people into enemies, to multiply the things that make other people into forever foreigners, that multiply the things that make, that multiply nationalism or tribalism, and in its most extreme form, to multiply violence and to multiply hate. And after a week like this week, a word like this feels all the more important to me. You know, I left work on Friday last week, and I thought, this is the first place that I've worked where Lunar New Year was a company holiday. Maybe this year I can celebrate and be really proud of who I am and not be worried that drawing too much attention would make me a target. There have been plenty of times in my life, but especially in the last 3 years, where being proud of who I am made me a target. You know, and I woke up on Sunday and I just thought, new year, new hope, you know? People were going to come over that night. We were going to try to do our best to have a Whole30 compliant hot pot. Then I opened my phone and I saw Monterey Park. It hit really close to home because I know that ballroom. My friend's mom, my auntie, she used to go there all the time to dance. And sure enough, over the next few days, I began to see pictures of victims who looked just like my auntie. And then before I was ready to process anything, Half Moon Bay, Oakland, and now hot on the heels of that, Tyree Nichols. Guys, we've got to figure this out. We have got to learn the difference between restitution and repair, and we have got to get better at prioritizing repair. Because what's the point of going from lawsuit to lawsuit saying they got the verdict right there and they definitely mess up the verdict there if it's just a matter of time before another news article and another incident and another lawsuit? No, the justice of God wants so much more than that, and the justice of the God that we worship will not rest until there is true healing and reconciliation, until wholeness, until anyone can leave their house anytime, at any day, and not be afraid that they might not make it home that night. We have got to learn the difference between restitution and repair, and we have got to do better at prioritizing repair. And if you think that God is just trying to put you on trial, to issue some sort of invoice of impossible to meet requirements, then it's just a matter of time before you start to hate yourself. And that hate will multiply, and you will start to hate people whose faces look like and remind you of your own face. And then we end up right here. But this is not the God that we worship, and this is not what God wants. This is not God's repair language. What God is saying in this passage is, this is what I want. I want you to go back to that time and that place where in your lived experience you knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that you were made in the image of God. And if that's challenging, maybe that's the first place for repair. And then I want you to get really good at recognizing the image of God wherever you go, so that when you see someone who doesn't look anything like you, you will recognize the image of God in that person. And then I want you to love them like they were one of your own. And then I want both of you and everyone else who agrees to stand up and take personal responsibility to tend and guard and nurture the flourishing of that beloved community. And I want you to make as many of those as you can. That is God's repair language. That is what the Lord requires of you. That is what the Lord requires of me, Maximus Lee, and that is what the Lord requires of us, Oakland City Church, especially if we dare to call ourselves a church of people who don't belong together, gathered around Jesus for the sake of those who don't belong. This is how we say to God, I'm sorry, I love you, and I get it. This is our God's repair language. God doesn't care about offerings and sacrifices. What's the point of that if you're just going from sacrifice to sacrifice and lawsuit to lawsuit? But a broken and contrite heart I will not despise, because that's the repair opportunity. This is why when Peter is asked to make repair, Jesus Christ asked him, do you love me, Peter? Feed my sheep. Over and over in that moment, that repair process, the question is, do you love me, Peter? Feed my sheep. This is the call. We have got to get better at doing this for ourselves, for our loved ones, and for our community. This is the dream and the vision that God is working towards every day. And this is the vision that God calls God's people to come, put our arms around each other, and walk in lockstep towards. Oakland City Church, we need to get better at repair. This is what the Lord is calling us to do. Let us get better at doing it together. Amen.